President Trump resurrects Reagan-era tradition, America needs it more than ever. President Donald Trump is not known to mince words or suffer fools. In fact, those that earn his ire generally receive sharp and often public criticism. His words generally set heads afire among the leftist progressives and political pundits in the mainstream media, yet his criticisms are generally earned. Neither does President Trump play by any set of rules but his own and follows General Washington protocol only insofar as it suits him. So when he steps into uncharted territory as he did recently, it behooves Americans to pay attention. In a move that set tongues wagging and jaws dropping all up and down Wall Street, President Trump offered public criticism of the Federal Reserve's recent decision to hike interest rates. During a recent interview with CNBC, the president made a shocking comment, stating his belief that a dollar puts us at a disadvantage and then went on to up the ante, stating he is not thrilled about the Fed's decision to raise rates because we go up and every time you go up they want to raise rates again. CNBC promptly went into hysterical convulsions proclaiming this as a stinging and historically rare criticism. The Wall Street Journal proclaimed that President Trump's remarks break with tradition that presidents refrain from commenting on monetary policy. Former Dallas Fed President Richard Fisher told CNBC that the president had overstepped, stating, "One of the hallmarks of our great American economy is preserving the independence of the Federal Reserve. No president should interfere with the workings of the Fed. Were I Chairman Powell, I would ignore the president and do my job, and I am confident he will do just that." President Trump paid them no mind. Just one day later, he doubled down tweeting that tightening now hurts all that we have done. The U.S. should be allowed to recapture what was lost due to illegal currency manipulation and bad trade deals. Debt coming due and we are raising rates, really? In yet another tweet, President Trump also went on to accuse China, the European Union and others of manipulating their currencies and interest rates lower, while the U.S. is raising rates while the dollars gets stronger and stronger with each passing day, taking away our big competitive edge. When CNBC aired the president's comments along with their hysterical commentary about the unprecedented nature of President Trump's criticism, just a scant few hours later, the White House issued a statement of denial. President Trump's remarks were in no way to be construed as a challenge to the independence of the Fed. Even as President Trump offered the mild criticism, he acknowledged his words broke with the practice followed by his recent predecessors and, as with most everything he does, was likely to provoke a firestorm of criticism. President Trump stated, "Now I'm just saying what I would have said as a private citizen." Some would say, "Oh, maybe you shouldn't say that as a president. I couldn't care less what they say. Because my views haven't changed. I don't like all this work we're putting into the economy, and then I see rates going up." Breitbart reports of President Trump's break in tradition dash. The tradition that puts comments about the Fed out of bounds for a president, however, has a much more recent and questionable provenance than the reaction to Trump's remarks suggest. It has its roots in the policy of Robert Rubin, the former co-chairman of Goldman Sachs who served as Bill Clinton's Treasury Secretary, who insisted that the Clinton White House not publicly question central bank policies. Presidents George Bush and Barack Obama also largely followed the Rubin rule. In breaking with the Rubin rule, Trump is hearkening back to the tactics of President Ronald Reagan, a frequent Fed critic. Reagan criticized the Federal Reserve Board after an unexpected spurt in the U.S. money supply. "The jump in the money supply sends, I think, the wrong signal to the money markets," Reagan said in a 1982 press conference. At the same conference, he also declined to take a position on whether Fed Chair Paul Volcker should resign, something that had been called for by Congressman Jack Kemp of New York. Those comments were echoed a month later in Reagan's annual economic message to Congress when he urged the Fed to follow a policy of gradual and less volatile reduction in the growth of the money supply. Unfortunately, the high and volatile money growth of the past, and the high inflation and high interest rates which accompanied it, were instrumental in bringing about the poor and highly uneven economic performance of 1980 and 1981, culminating in a sharp fall in output and a rise in unemployment in the latter months of 1981, Reagan said. Reagan's Council of Economic Advisers suggested in a report accompanying the president's remarks several reforms to monetary policy, including setting money supply targets by law or even a constitutional amendment. Reagan went even further while campaigning in the 1982 midterm elections. At a campaign event in New Jersey, Reagan said that the Fed had been working well in the past several weeks, an implicit criticism of its policies before that. He also raised the question of whether the Fed would work better if the Treasury Secretary was its head, as was the case when the central bank was founded. Until 1935, both the Treasury Secretary and the Controller of the Currency sat on the Fed board. They were replaced by two Fed governors appointed by the president, supposedly to reduce political influence over monetary policy. Those were not quite off-the-cuff remarks. Earlier that year, Treasury officials had said they were considering initiating a study of proposals to restrict the power of the Federal Reserve Board. The possibilities cited then included having the board placed under the Treasury Department's authority or putting the Treasury Secretary on the board, according to the New York Times. That provoked public criticism from Volcker, and eventually Treasury Secretary Donald T. Reagan publicly declared that there was no need for a study into ways to rein in the Fed. But even as Reagan backed off of the controversial study, he felt free to pronounce judgment on the Fed's policy, saying that he was pleased with the Fed's operations. The Fed and Volcker, who had been named chairman by Jimmy Carter in 1979, was wildly unpopular at the time. In an effort to fight inflation, Volcker put in place a very tight monetary policy that sent interest rates soaring and triggered a recession that saw unemployment rise above 10%. The Federal Reserve has long been the subject of much criticism, with former Representative Ron Paul, TXR, along with his son current Senator Rand Paul, GR, leading the charge of audit the Fed with staunch criticisms of the federal government's fiscal policies, especially the existence of the Federal Reserve and the tax policy. They are not alone. Former President John F. Kennedy Jr. shared this opinion, as do a great many others. President Trump himself has previously called to audit the Fed.